have lot of misunderstanding, lot of gaps in terms of understanding why God has brought this law. So actually I would say churches have divided as well in terms of understanding the concept of salvation and what is the purpose of law. So many churches tend to say, like, you know, we are saved by being obedient to the Ten Commandments. Many churches say we are saved by the law. Some churches say we are saved by grace by following the law. Not only grace is sufficient, but even we need to follow the law. So some say we are saved by the works of the law. So there is different understanding in the entire global community of believers. So what I wanted to tell you, each and everyone, is when we are looking at the Bible, do not look it as two books, Old Testament and New Testament, Old Covenant and New Covenant. Though in a sense it is true, but not in a holistic context. You need to see it as two books, because Bible is a progressive revelation. From Genesis to Revelation, it is God's story actually. It is God's story towards the mankind to redeem the mankind from the sin. So Bible is a progressive revelation. God has a plan, and the plan is continuous. Progressive means continuous. You cannot separately see Old Testament and New Testament separately. There is a connection. The connection is nothing but the complete plan of God from Genesis to Revelation. That's how we call it as progressive revelation. Means there is a connection between Old Testament to New Testament, which connects between Old Testament and New Testament. Anyhow, coming to the context, again, God has a full-fledged plan from Genesis to Revelation. So God, as part of the Old Covenant, as part of the Old Testament, God has brought the concept of law. And as part of the New Covenant, New Testament, after the coming of Jesus Christ, God brought the concept of grace. So you may have a question like, does God not know why he had a plan to bring both the law and the grace? Does God, we call him omniscient, does he not know that the law will not stand? What is the purpose for God bringing the law then? God is omniscient, means all knowledgeable. Why he has to bring two concepts of law and the grace? God could straight away put grace into consideration. Why there was a need of law? While I say this, I am not saying there is no grace in the Old Testament. Yes, there was grace even in the Old Testament. Even if you see the Old Testament believers, we see even Abraham. Abraham believed in God and he was considered as righteous. There was grace of God even in the Old Testament, but there is a different purpose of God when he brought the law into consideration, primarily where he wanted the people of Israel to follow the law, to be holy. Okay, so let us understand the first point, getting into what is the purpose of God giving the law. So we see in Exodus 24:12 and Exodus 31:18. Let me read through this. The law was brought by Moses when God commanded Moses to come on the mount, Mount Sinai. We see this in Exodus 24:12. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and stay here, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and commandments I have written for their instruction." Means God has given the law to the Moses, and he instructed Moses to go and tell this to the people of Israel. Okay, so let us even see Exodus 31:18. When the Lord finished speaking to Moses on Mount Sinai, he gave him the two tablets of the covenant law, the tablets of stone inscribed by the finger of God. So we need to understand, the law was given to Moses and the law was written on the tablets of stone. This is very, very important for us to understand. The law was written on the tablets of stone. Very important. That is where, because the law is written on the tablets of stone, which is an external entity, how can this law transform the heart of a person? Because it is written on the stones. With this scripture, when I move to next points, what was the purpose of God for bringing the law? So God wanted the Israel to be a separate nation. God wanted the Israel to be a separate nation where, so that it is an example to the rest of all the nations, all the Gentile nations. So God wanted the people of Israel to be holy. So that is the reason God brought this law, so that Israel may follow this law and they become holy by following the law, so that Israel is set as an example for the rest of all the nations. That is the purpose for which God brought the law. God knows, as I said, right? So God knows that in future He is going to give a new covenant which is based on the grace. But if we do not have an understanding of the law, how will you understand the grace of God? Right? If we do not understand the law, the purpose of the law was to make the people understand the knowledge of sin. We see the scripture now, Romans 3:20. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. Rather, through the law we became conscious of our sin. So, do you understand why did God give the law? God gave the law so that we have the consciousness of sin. When God created the mankind, was there any sin? There was no sin. Genesis 1:31, everything was good when God created the mankind. But when Adam and Eve committed sin, the sin came into this world. And if there is no consciousness of the sin, then what we tend to do? We manifest the sinful nature. And how can the Israel be holy when God's intention is Israel to be holy and a different nation when it compares to the rest of all the world? So, in order for the Israel people to have the knowledge of sin, God brought the concept of the law. Okay? And one important point what I want you to understand is, the law was brought only to the Israel, not to the world, not to you and me. We are in the new covenant. We are in the grace of God. This is very, very important for you to understand. The law was brought only for Israelites, so that they understand the knowledge of sin, so that they can make every effort to live a holy life, so that they are different when they are looked at by the other nations. Galatians 3:23-26. Before the coming of the faith, we were held in custody under the law, looked up until the faith that was to come would be revealed. So the law was our guardian until Christ came, that we might be justified by faith. Now that the faith has come, we are no longer under the guardian. Do you see this? The law, here I will repeat again. We see that until the faith has come, until the coming of Jesus Christ. When did the faith come? The faith is nothing but the coming of Lord Jesus Christ as a Savior, is nothing but the faith. So until the faith has come, we were under the custody, under the law. What it means? Means until Jesus Christ came, the law was in force. But the moment Jesus Christ came, we are no longer under the law. That is what Paul is very clearly writing to the Galatian church. Now that the faith has come, we are no longer under this guardian of law. So in Jesus Christ, you all are the children of God through faith. Matthew 5:17. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophet. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. Because the law was written on the stones, was anyone made righteous by the law? We saw in the scripture, right? No one is made righteous by the works of the law. Means, even the people of Old Testament, all the people of the Old Covenant, were not made righteous by the law. Right? So, then, if the Old Testament people were not made righteous by the law, then why did God bring this law into consideration? I explained that He brought this so that we have the knowledge of sin. If there is no law, there is no sin. Suppose, we being the parents, when our children make some noise, right? We discipline them by giving some instruction. An instruction is nothing but a law. Do not do this. If you don't tell to your child, don't do this, he will do it. The moment you put an instruction and a command to your child not to do it, it is a law from the father to the child. Similarly, when God created this entire universe, there was no sin. But when sin came into existence because of Adam and Eve, if you don't control the people of God, whom God has chosen, the people of Israel, and if you don't control them by the law, then the entire Israel community will be committing sin. Then the God's purpose that Israel need to be holy people, different people when looked at by other nations, will not be fulfilled. So that is the reason God brought the law, so that the Israel have the knowledge of sin. We see in Romans 5:13. Sorry, before that let us go Romans 7:7. What shall we say then? Is the law sinful? Certainly not. Nevertheless, I would have not known what sin was had it not been for the law. For I would have not known what coveting really was if the law had not said, you shall not covet. Means, if there was no law, I would not have any knowledge of sin. If I do not have an understanding of the law, then I would have been continuously committing sin because I do not understand the law. So the law has brought the knowledge of sin to the mankind. So because of this law, we were able to understand that we lost the fellowship of God. We are in a situation of a danger because of this sin. You are going to get condemned to hell. Because of this sin, You are made to understand the need of a savior. Because of this sin, because of you committing sin, because of you engrossed in the sin without having a knowledge of sin, you would have destined for hell, destined for condemnation. Because of the knowledge of sin, because of the knowledge of the law, you are able to understand the total depravity state of the mankind because of the sin which is within us. So the law brought the people of God to the Savior. Because of the law, we are able to understand what sin is. Though the law did not save the people from the sin, but it gave the knowledge of sin, it gave an understanding that if you do not understand the law, you are going to be getting condemned to hell and total depravity, that you need a savior and introduction to the savior. So now you tell me, God being omniscient, does God did not know why he brought this law? The law is nothing but a trailer. You all might be knowing, you might be watching movies. Before the release of the movies, you know, you will have a trailer, right? So similarly, God in his plan also has put the trailer in the form of law. The trailer will tell you what is upcoming, what is actually movie. Here the law also is telling what is upcoming. The law is telling you need a savior. The law is telling you will be going to hell and perishing in sin. That is the purpose for which God brought the law. 13. Romans 5:13. To be sure, sin was in this world before the law was given, but sin is not charged against anyone's account when there is no law. Wonderful. So that what I explained just now, the law came after the sin came. Even the scripture is telling the same. If there is no law, then there is no accountability for a person. The forgiveness of this sin, if there is no law. Because when the sin is there, you can hold a person committing sin to be accountable of that sin. If there is no law, then there is no accountability. If there is no law, there is a freedom of sin. Everyone can enjoy the world like anything. If you do not have an understanding of the law, how will you understand the grace of God? Now, with this background, I want you to understand the situation now. Imagine there is no Jesus Christ. Imagine there is no grace. There is only law. Then each one of us now will think, oh, because of this law, I am made accountable of this sin. Because of this sin, I am going to go to hell and condemnation into the fire. I don't want to go to the fire. Give me the solution. You all will ask me, or Anthony, or anyone, give me the solution. Oh, this is a very problematic situation. No, I don't want to go to hell. Please help me. What is the solution? So, the solution is the grace of God. If you do not understand the law, how will you understand the grace? So that is the reason God gave the trailer, which is the law. Through the law, you are made to understand the consciousness of the sin. You are made to understand the impact of the sin. You are made to understand the depravity situation of the sin. When God created the man, he was 100% holy. There was no sin. But because of the Adam sin, the entire mankind, the entire creation realm, including this entire nature, is culminated with this sin. And you are in a state of total condemnation and total punishment from God, which is God's wrath. If there is no grace, each one of us are worthy of God's wrath. So, that in order for you to understand the depths of the love of God, the mercy of God, the love of God, the steadfast love of God, which is in the form of God's grace, you will not understand the God's grace if you don't understand the law. Now, example, the law is given very clearly in Leviticus 19:20. If you say, do not murder, no one who commits the murder will enter into the kingdom of God. That is the law. Suppose today I murdered some person. Okay? What the law is saying? No one will enter into heaven. So how will I go to heaven if I murder someone? That is the law. Then I will have a fear saying that I am going to get condemned to hell and I don't want to get condemned to hell. Then I need an unmerited favor from God. From someone, unmerited favor means you cannot earn it, you cannot buy it, it is given freely, which is nothing but from the gift of God, which is nothing but God's grace. So Jesus is the God's grace who manifested himself in the form of God's grace. So Jesus is the grace who came into this world as part of the new covenant to bring out us from this law, from the bondage and slavery of this law. So Romans 5:13. Did we read Romans 5:13? Yes, I guess I'll read again. To be sure, sin was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not charged against anyone's account when there is no law. Okay, I explained you. The next step comes Hebrew 10:1-4. Let me read. The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the reality themselves. So what is the law? Law is only a shadow. Suppose when you are entering a house, when the shadow goes first, does it mean that you have already entered the house? It is only the shadow. It is not actual substance. The actual reality which is to come is in the Lord Jesus Christ. So the law is only the shadow of Jesus Christ. The law is only the shadow of the actual substance, the actual grace of God, which is yet to come as part of the new covenant. Okay, so let me continue to read this. The law is only a shadow of good things that are coming, not the reality themselves. Means the law is not reality. The law is not full-fledged solution. That is what it is telling. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices, repeatedly, endlessly, year after year, make perfect those who draw near to the worship. The law was given in the old covenant that if you commit any sin, you need to offer some sacrifice, some dove, some goat, some lamb, or different forms. So that is the sacrificial model which God has given as part of the law. But the scripture is very clearly telling, this will not give you permanent cleansing of the heart, because of which the man is offering the sacrifices again and again for the same sin. You know one thing, as part of the old covenant, if you commit one sin, that guilt was there as part of your heart everlastingly, as part of the old covenant. That is the reason what used to happen is, when you go and offer a sacrifice for the sin what you have committed today, maybe you offer a dove or a lamb or anything, after 1 month, maybe after 2 months, the consciousness of the guilt used to come again, and you used to go again and again offer the sacrifice for the same sin. And this used to happen repeatedly, continuously, for the same sin again and again. Because how can, in Hebrews it is written, bloodshed of the animals will cleanse a man for the sin what he has committed. Okay, so let us see that. So yes, verse 2, otherwise would they not have stopped being offered? Means, if the consciousness, if the guilt of the sin what you have committed, if it is cleansed, then why you would continuously go and offer the sacrifices? For the worshippers would have been cleansed once for all, and would no longer have felt guilt for their sins. But those whose sacrifices are annual reminder of sins, it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away the sins. So, this was the law which was given as part of the old covenant for any person committing sin. Then, they used to offer this sacrifice as part of this law. This concept comes as part of the law which is called ceremonial laws. There are three types of laws in the old covenant. First is ceremonial laws, second is moral laws, and third is civil laws. So I will not get it into there today, but I will try to spend time in the next session on these three types of law, and I will spend taking an example of how the sacrificial system was there in the Old Testament and what is the response to it in the New Testament. Similarly, cleansing, festivals, Sabbath, clothing, circumcision, memorial days, festivals, holy days, all these things I will take an example. I will relate the scripture from the Old Testament and I will connect it to the New Testament for the next section. But moving ahead, now that you understood that the law is only the shadow of the things which are yet to come, which are in the new covenant, which are in the grace of God, which are nothing but in the Lord Jesus Christ.